Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the same comfort that we ourselves have received from God. I welcome you to this memorial and thanksgiving service for the life of Pastor Uziel, who was a part of this community here at St. Crucis, but also the wider Lutheran community here in the border region. For all those streaming in from overseas, welcome. I'm Pastor H.P. von Fintel, and Pastor Frank will be doing this devotion a bit later. Dear friends in Christ, we have gathered here this morning to celebrate and remember the life of Pastor Uziel Campos de Oliveira Jr. We are gathered here this morning with mixed feelings. On one side, we are gathered with feelings of sadness and sorrow over the loss of a family member, but also a wonderful, humble friend, but also a colleague. But we also gather here this morning with feelings of thankfulness for the life of Pastor Uziel and the blessing that he was to his family, but also to us as a community in which he served. We also gather here this morning to seek reassurance and comfort from our Heavenly Father, because when we're honest, death frightens us, it fills us with anxiety. In the Gospel of John, we hear the following. Jesus Christ says, "I am the light of the world. This light shines in the darkness, and darkness did not overcome it." That's why the Christ candle is lit today, reminding us that Christ is present with us here in this service this morning, but also present with us in our homes where we are viewing the service too. This morning, we're going to start off with a wonderful hymn, "Now Thank We All Our God." Every part of the service is put together, keeping in mind who Pastor Uziel was. And we all know Pastor Uziel had a passion for praising God through his music, spreading God's message of grace through his music. And Pastor Uziel loved praising God, giving thanks to God in every situation. But we are also gathered here this morning to give thanks to God for the blessing that Pastor Uziel was to each one of us in a different way that he touched our life. So let us stand and let us sing together the wonderful hymn, "Now Thank We All Our God."
Thank you.
You may be seated. Every little person mattered to Pastor Aziel. No matter where we went, if we went to a restaurant with him, he would always inquire who the waiter was and always find out a bit more about this person who is serving him. And this was out of a conviction, because he believed each and every single person was created by God, uniquely created by God, was God's special child. And Pastor Uziel was always listening to people, what was on their heart. He had that special gift. And very often when I'm Pastor Uziel spoke, a psalm that we came back to was Psalm 139. And I invite you now to answer with part C on this psalm. O Lord, you have searched me and know me.
You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away.
You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted in all my ways.
Even before the words on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely.
You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it.
For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
God's works are wonderful, and God created Pastor Uziel with a special gift, that of music. And that was also Pastor Uziel's passion that he brought to us here in South Africa. But worldwide he shared this passion, this love with so many people. And one of them is my wife. He not only taught my wife to play the guitar, but helped her to discover the wonderful gift of writing songs. Many a Wednesday, they together wrote songs, and the first song that they wrote is what she wants to sing now to us, Fearfully, Wonderfully Made. Let us stand and let us pray. Heavenly Father, you see deep in our hearts. You know everything about us. You know whether we are working, resting. You know whether we come or go. No matter where we are never out of your sight. Even before we speak a word, you already know what we are going to say. Your reassuring presence surrounds us at all times. Thank you for this assurance that we may know this morning that you are also with us. Where we remember, celebrate, but also say goodbye to a special person in our lives. We ask you to come close this morning with us with your reassuring presence. In our time of need, in our time of sadness, in our time of grief, in our time of weakness. Father, we know that you love us. We've experienced your mercy and faithfulness in the past, and it has sustained us through many difficult seasons. Be with us this morning. Comfort us with your peace and your comfort. Help us to trust in you. Renew, guide us with your love. We pray all of this in your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Different things were important for Pastor Oziel, but one of those things that was very important, a foundation in his faith, was that little word, hope. He clung to the hope that we have in God, no matter what situation he found himself in, because he knew that this hope would not disappoint him. But what is this hope all about that we as children of God have? Paul describes to us this hope that we have in the letter to the Romans, chapter 5. Therefore, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've gained access by faith into the grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, just at the right time, when we were powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Since we've now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more have we been reconciled? Shall we be saved through his love? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've now received reconciliation. Let us stand and let us confess our Christian faith with the words of Apostles' Creed, and our Lord and Savior who reconciled us with God, giving us a sure and certain hope that we are children of God.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. I ask that Brigitte, that you come in front and read your little thing that you wrote in memory of Pastor Aziel. I ask that Leanne, you come, then Diana, Frank, and then I'll still read a greeting from the bishop.
Dear friends and family of Pastor Aziel, it is with a very heavy heart that we say farewell to our friend and brother in Christ, Pastor Aziel. In our lives, we sometimes have the great privilege to meet a person that changes our lives in such a positive way. Pastor Aziel was such a person for me. He truly touched my life with his kindness, his patience, and his wholehearted love for the life-changing gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the hope that we have in him. He radiated such joy and lived his life to the fullest, always giving praise and thanks to God through his preaching, his music, songwriting, and his great care for everyone he met. He shared his wisdom, his knowledge, and his passion for music freely and with great generosity. In August 2019, Pastor Aziel started teaching me to play the guitar. In our very first lesson together, he said to me, with the biggest smile on his face, "It is easy. I will show you." He did so much more than that. He taught me the basic chords, but he inspired me to believe in myself and to gain the confidence in the God-given talent of music. He taught me to find inspiration in God's word, in the creation around us, and through living our daily lives. We spent many wonderful hours together playing the guitar, listening to music, writing new songs together, and sharing our love for our Lord Jesus and the people in our community. By December 2019, Pastor Aziel and I had written a Christmas song together titled "What an Ordinary Night," and a song based on Psalm 139, titled "So Fearfully and Wonderfully Created." There have been many songs since then, and I have always had Pastor Aziel helping me and guiding me along the way. I will truly miss my musical mentor, but will continue writing new songs to honor our friendship and to give praise to our Lord Jesus. I will miss his smile, his kind words, and his joyful life. Rest in peace, my dear friend, until we meet again.
How is it possible that somebody you have known for such a short period of time can leave you with a memory bank that is overflowing with wonderful, happy, and cherished memories? And I'm sure I'm not the only one who feels this way. I met Pastor Aziel soon after he arrived in East London on his first trip. I took him to buy a guitar for the church, and that was a day that I realized that this man has a heart and passion for those less fortunate than himself. After we had bought the guitar, we went to get a milkshake from the Friesland in the Quigney. He sat in the car waiting for me because we were going to drink our milkshakes on the beachfront. And when I got back to the car, I was bombarded with questions about the children that are in the street. Do they go to school? Where do they go to school? Etc. And those challenging questions that I did not always have the answers for never stopped. We sat on the beachfront drinking our milkshakes, and I got to know Aziel, the husband and father, who had such love and devotion for his wife and family. I heard all about Cheryl, Kayla, Dulcinea, Karina, David and Ivani. And by the end of that afternoon, I felt like I had met his whole family. I also remember the day that he was going to be driving himself home from church on his own, without accompaniment, with the use of a GPS. I happened to be driving behind him, and at the top of the road where he should have turned left to go to Beacon Bay, he turned right. Needless to say, I followed him, left onto the N2, left onto the Northeast Expressway, and right into Southernwood. which is where I was able to stop him. I was panicked. Here was this man, new country, new road rules, driving on the opposite side of the road to what he's used to. And I'm thinking, what is he feeling? And I get there and I say to him, Pastor, I say, where are you going? And I get met with this biggest smile, this cheeky little grin that says, I don't know. I pressed home. Maybe it's taking me to Brazil. So, yes, that cheeky little grin with that mischievous smile and the twinkling in the eye never left him. Pastor Oziel also spoke many languages. He had a love for languages. And there was a group of us that attended the Christmas in July function that the Luther congregation held. And as typical in the Eastern Cape, a lot of Afrikaans music was being played. Pastor Oziel and Cheryl sat at our table, and we had to constantly tell him the words of the songs. And you could see the cogs in his brain working overtime, trying to understand this new language that had come across his path. He also had the knack of never giving you a direct answer when you asked him a biblical question, when you were grappling with a passage in the Bible, and you'd ask him for an answer. His go-to response was, well, what do you think? And he would continue to ask those challenging questions until you arrived at your own conclusion. I remember a personal discussion I once had with him, and his advice was honest and direct. He was not going to apologize to me if my feelings were a bit bruised. It was the truth, and I needed to deal with it. He was never a man to compromise on telling you the truth. But he also had such a sense of humor. And I don't know how many of you remember the time during one of his sermons, he spoke about that he had attended this conference that was with pastors from various denominations, from all over. And the one pastor asked him if he'd ever prayed for healing. And of course he said yes, and this guy said, well, do you mind if I pray for you? And he said, sure. And this gentleman prayed very, very earnestly, and for a while, and as the 10 minutes were ticking by, Pastor Oziel said he knew it wasn't going to happen. But in the back of his mind, he still thought, he wonders, what happens if this guy's right? And what happens if he does get healed? The first thing he's going to have to do is phone Cheryl to bring him another shoe, because he only had one shoe. And yeah, and I've got another cherished memory of him with his love for music, as we all know. I've got a memory of him sitting with my father, who has since passed away as well, on the veranda on our farm. And if my memory serves me correct, I'm under correction, but I don't think he'd ever heard a concertina being played. My father was playing this concertina, and in no time he picked up the guitar and he was strumming along. And he then even tried his hand at playing this concertina. My heart is sore that we are not going to see this special man here on earth again. But I'm happy when I think of how joyful he must be. He always said he was not afraid to die. And I can picture him completely healed. No polio, no COVID, singing, dancing, singing, playing music, and dancing without worrying that he's going to fall, and is wearing two of the same shoes. Rest in peace, Pastor Oziel, and thank you for being you, and for all the wonderful memories that you've left us with. And I know that I speak for not only myself, but for many people when I say that Cheryl will always be a part of our St. Cruces family, till we meet again.
I have a message from the Bellingham family. They unfortunately are away at the moment, and as we know, in his second visit, that was where he stayed. They had a beautiful flat at the back of their yard, and that was where Pastor Oziel and Cheryl resided for more than a year. And so with them being away, I did ask Pete to send a message. We would have loved to attend the memorial service for Pastor Oziel, but we are away on vacation and it is not possible. Glenda and I had the privilege to assist with Pastor Oziel and Cheryl's accommodation for the duration of their stay in South Africa. However, their stay brought about true friendship between us and, needless to say, a strong bond. Our almost daily interactions The many meals shared, socials, road trips to various parts of our country, as well as many discussions about the wide spectrum of topics, allowed us to realize that Pastor Oziel was an inspirational intellectual with a wide knowledge of life and of a people's person. As he was a man of very strong faith, there's no doubt that he is now with his Redeemer. He often expressed he had no fear of dying, as he knew and had faith in his Redeemer. We will not always understand why he was taken so soon, as he will be missed dearly for his evangelical work. He will certainly be a loss to society, and more specifically, the church community. Oziel, you were a true friend and a magnificent man. The void that has been left from your passing will never be filled. You are a legend in your own right and will never be forgotten by the Bellingham family. May your soul rest in peace. Our sincere condolences to Cheryl and the rest of his family. We will continue to pray for God's strength and blessing during this time of mourning. The Bellingham family. Well, for me, I'd like to say, let me start out by saying that I truly believe God sends people into our lives, not by accident, but for a reason. And I'm certain that Pastor Oziel's brief time in my life was one of those special crossings that was sent by God. Where does one begin with Pastor Oziel? It started out when Bishop Filter started to arrange for a retired pastor from Brazil to assist us in Cruz's congregation in the absence of a full-time pastor. Then the excitement and the apprehension in the build-up to Pastor Oziel's arrival was hilarious. Would he be able to speak English? Would he understand our ways? Was he going to manage to stay in a flat on his own until his dear wife Cheryl could arrive after her back surgery? And so it went. And then he arrived. This man who just radiated his peaceful, friendly nature from the start, and there was no doubt that he was going to be such an asset to our congregation. We had purchased, Althea and I had gone out and got basic groceries for his needs and put them in his flat, but I had been told that he needed to have eggs, as that was the only thing that he could actually prepare for himself. So we ensured that there were 6 eggs there. Later, I believe that day after he had arrived, he walked around the flat showing Cheryl all the food that we had put there and asking what he needed to do with it. So he still relied on his better half. Nonetheless, I do believe that when Cheryl arrived about 2 months later, that there were still a couple of the 6 eggs left in the fridge. During his short first visit, it became clear that he truly arrived in our congregation as God's plan in an answer for our prayers for a pastor. Pastor Oziel made sure that he didn't just meet people at church. He made sure that he came to know the people of St. Cruces and even folk that were not part of our congregation. He showed us that church did not only happen inside this building of St. Cruces. There are so many fond memories that I have of Pastor Oziel. The one that I had to get used to was him photographing everyone and everything for his memories. I detested it, but I soon got used to that camera, that iPad came up and he recorded everything. Cheryl and her family will have years of footage to remember where they have been and what Oziel has done. Another memory of Pastor Oziel was the one evening he came through to Gunubi for Bible study. Firstly, he arrived rather early. I think he was used to getting lost at that stage. And he said the garment always took him to the wrong place. But I have to wonder if he ever listened to instructions. He drove around the beachfront in Gunubi and then stopped to interact with people whom he asked for directions and told them about our church and about the gospel. Somehow he just managed to pull it off because he absolutely celebrated the crucified and risen Lord. Anyway, we enjoyed a lovely time learning about God's word and then singing, and at about 9 o'clock, Pastor Oziel set off back to Beacon Bay, to his flatlet. Only a few weeks later did he tell me that he had something to confess to me. Well, by now I had learnt he was quite a tease, and he had a very big sense of humour. And I had no idea what was going to come out of this confession. Pastor Oziel had apparently driven out of Ganubi, but somehow landed himself after 9 o'clock at night in the middle of Mzimotle Township. He said he drove around for a while trying to get his bearing, and he could not find the main road, he said, and he felt as though he was driving around in circles. When he stopped the car and asked people for directions, they didn't help much, and he felt that they were kind of nervous about this very strange white man driving around that spoke to them in a funny, funny accent. Well, by now it was actually well after 11 o'clock. When asked why he did not want to phone one of us for help, he said he wasn't scared and we would actually panic. After a while, he noticed a bucky bringing some staff back and pulled up next to them to ask them for help. And he said, this chap, just as the staff jumped off, he took off at a major speed. And one of the workers looked at him and then realized that this man might be lost. And he just said, follow that bucky, follow that bucky. And that was what he did. Thankfully, Pastor Oziel did that and managed to get himself back onto Ganubi Main Road and found his way home. Walking alongside Pastor Oziel was been an amazing opportunity. He never forced his thoughts onto any situation. When doing Bible study with him during lockdown, marathon sessions that required Leanne to keep logging us into the new meeting as our 40 minutes on Zoom were over, was inspiring. Not only the way in which he shared his amazing knowledge, but by using the simple phrase, yes, but what do you think? I think that these words will stay with me forever, but most importantly, may his lessons of listening, hearing, and caring for everyone be seeds that will grow within me. Pastor Oziel never allowed anything to hold him back, and I was always aware of how he found hope in every single situation. I personally am forever grateful for God's plan to send Pastor Oziel and Cheryl into my life for the short season that they spent in South Africa, and will treasure all the moments in my heart. I do believe that Cheryl will feel the immense loss of her lifetime partner of 49 years, and my prayers will remain with her always. May God bring strength and peace to Cheryl and all their family as they mourn the passing of their loved one. And I close by sharing this verse. They're not my words, but I do feel that it sums up Pastor Oziel, who meant so much to me and to others. You lived a life with little needs, full instead of selfless deeds. For everyone you did your best, may God grant you eternal rest. Go in peace, till we meet again.
My memories of Pastor Oziel by Althea Bayer. Our dear Pastor Oziel, what a special person, and what a brave man he was to come to South Africa. He knew very little about us at St. Crucis, but he was willing to take up the challenge and travel across the South Atlantic Ocean to share God's word with us. I remember the day that he first arrived at the East London airport. Although exhausted after being in transit for so many hours, his face bore a smile that we would all soon grow to love. Shortly after he was settled into his furnished flat in Beacon Bay, I soon found out that he was not a very good cook. I soon made plans to get a meal each day for him. Thank you to all the members of the congregation who assisted during this time. Fortunately, Cheryl was soon able to travel and join him a few weeks later. I will never forget the day when he told me that he had attended a church service in Buffalo Flats and had also been invited to one in Tanzania. He, on many occasions thereafter, referred to my facial expressions and lots of words at hearing this. Pastor Israel trusted in God and he trusted everyone. Pastor Oziel was a night owl. He would often send a WhatsApp or even phone me in the wee hours of the night. He clearly was a man who did not need too much sleep. He was humble, kind, loving, and generous, and had an amazing mischievous nature. He and Cheryl kept very close contact with the members of our congregation. During lockdown, when visiting was not permitted, he would still keep in touch with regular phone calls. Pastor Ziel loved to play the guitar and wrote several hymns which he taught us. Even though we never got the beat that he expected, he never gave up on us. His guitar would accompany him on many of these visits, even if it was just to sing happy birthday to someone. What a privilege it was for us to have Pastor Ziel and Cheryl with us. He was a great man of God, and he shared so much. He taught us all to look at life with joy, trust, hope, and thankfulness. Pastor Ziel, you are now in God's arms. You touched my heart, and I will miss you. Rest in peace, Althea.
The last word belongs to our bishop, Bishop Gilbert Filter wrote the following and asked me to read it on his behalf. He's with us in his thoughts and prayers this morning. The Lord is risen, he is risen indeed. Alleluia. Dear Cheryl, dear family, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it is with deep sadness and pain that we part from our beloved brother in Christ, Oziel de Oliveira. May he rest in peace. Pastor Oziel lived a rich and fulfilled life. His passion for people and for the gospel gave him the boldness to get out of retirement, leave home, and serve amongst us in South Africa. What an enriching experience that was to have him and you, dear Cheryl, among us here. The wisdom and enthusiasm with which both of you shared the gospel encouraged and empowered many to shine for Christ. We thank you and we praise you, and we praise the Lord for his gift he gave us in sending you to walk with us here. May you be comforted in the ever presence of the risen Lord, who said to his disciples before he departed from this world, "Surely I'm with you always till the very end of age." Matthew 28, verse 20. In prayer and thought, we walk with you united in Christ. With kind regards, Bishop Gilbert Filter. Is there anybody else that still wants to share? That brings us to our next hymn. Pastor Oziel loved teaching. Pastor Oziel loved teaching us hymns. And the one that he taught over and over is "Teach Us, O Gracious Lord." Now, this last week you would have noticed that the devotions were based on this hymn. I chose it for a reason when I did the devotions, because for me it just summed up the way that Oziel lived his life with joy, that smile on the picture. Thanks, Alvin, for that picture. It's a wonderful picture. This hymn also sums it up for me, being guided by God, seeking God's wisdom in all situations, but above all, loving his neighbor. We all shared and got a piece of his love that he shared with us, but also the joy in God's creation. Being in the Kruger Park and just coming back with this biggest smile on his face, and over the stories that we had to hear, just about this passion for God's creation. But as the last verse so nicely says it of his hymn, he was always deeply thankful for the cross of his Lord and Saviour. Let us stand and let us sing all four verses.
Sisters in Christ, what I am about to say might surprise you a bit at first, but bear with me, you will understand it later. So here goes. Today we are gathered not to remember a saint, but a sinner. But how can I say that? Well, of all of you, I most probably have known Pastor Oziel the least. I only met him twice. Yet on both these occasions, Pastor Oziel left an impression on me, because I could feel that he was someone who knew exactly what matters most in our faith and in our lives. This especially became clear to me at my interview, when I introduced myself to the church committee of St. Cruces before I was elected as the new pastor here. Throughout the conversation and the questions that were discussed, Pastor Oziel just sat there, just observing everything and saying nothing. However, right at the end, he said that he had just one question for me, and this was it. What is, in your opinion, the core message of the Christian faith? He asked. For a moment I had thought about it, and then answered by saying, for me the core message of the Christian faith is, as some theologians put it, the unconditional acceptance of the unacceptable through Christ alone. In other words, the free gift of God's grace. After that, Pastor Oziel just looked at me and then he smiled and said, I agree. And that is why I say that we are today gathered here not to remember or celebrate the life of a saint, but rather we remember a sinner who knew exactly who his Saviour was, who knew exactly that all that really matters when it comes to our faith and our relationship with God is God's undeserved and unconditional acceptance of you and me, the unacceptable. And it's not something that Pastor Oziel or I just like to say because it sounds nice. No, we say that because we believe that that is also what Jesus Christ himself proclaimed through his life, his death, and his resurrection. And there are many verses in the Bible that also underline this, especially within the letters of Paul. We find a number of texts that support this. For example, we read in the letters to the Romans, in the letter to the Romans in chapter 3, for everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God, in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. Or in the letter to the Ephesians, we read in chapter 2, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. Words that clearly speak of God's grace that saves through our faith in Jesus Christ alone. And yet, for me there is nothing, no words, no text that explains to us the love and grace of God better than one of the best known stories from the Bible. It's a story told by Jesus himself, known to us as the story of the prodigal son, or the parable of the lost son. We all have heard this story hundreds of times before, and yet it seems as if our memories aren't very good. Because time and time again, we seem to forget what this story is trying to tell us about God, our Heavenly Father. So let's listen to this story once again so that our memory may be refreshed. I read from Luke chapter 15. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, "I want my share of your estate now, before you die." So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land, and there he wasted all his money in wild living. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant.'" And so he returns to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. And kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found." And so the party began. I just never seem to get tired of this story. A story about which some say that if everything would be lost or forgotten from the Bible except for this story, then all would still be saved. Because this story in itself tells us all we need to know about the God whom Jesus called his Father. A loving, forgiving, and so always so merciful Father, who out of grace alone, in spite of everything the Son had done, in spite of the stench and the dirt from the pigs that still clung to him, in spite of all that, upon his return, this Father runs up towards his Son and embraces him and accepts him back into the house and into the family. No questions asked. Just pure grace and love and forgiveness. And this love, grace and forgiveness is what Jesus lived by. That is what he taught. And that is what he proclaimed right through to the bitter end when he hung on the cross, crying out for all to hear, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." And then with his final breath saying, "It is finished." Knowing that the work of grace is done, there and then on that cross. It is finished. There's nothing more to add from you or from my side, nothing more that needs to be done. It is finished. And that is, I believe, what Apostle Ezekiel lived by. This amazing grace of God, which he proclaimed through the songs he wrote and through his whole life, always, as I have been told, reaching out to the lost sons and daughters that are out there, sharing with them the good news of Jesus Christ, who has revealed to us God's unconditional acceptance, and who through faith alone turned us, the unacceptable sinner, not into some perfect saint, but into a saved sinner, whose life depends on nothing more than on God's free gift of love and forgiveness and mercy. And if today, in any way, we should want to honor Pastor Uziel, then not with many big words or the like, but rather by simply doing what he did, proclaiming the grace of God and Christ alone with words and deeds wherever we go. And by that, it's by that we shall remember a very special saved sinner who has gone before us and is now with his Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, where he may rest now in the presence of our Heavenly Father, engulfed by love, grace, and peace for all eternity. Amen. And may the grace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, now and forevermore.
Indeed, a hymn that reminds us about God's love for us all. We've come to the part of the service where we want to part from Pastor Uziel in peace and reconciliation. If we have loved Pastor Oziel, let us treasure his love beyond his death. If Pastor Oziel's life meant something to us, let us praise God and thank God, our Creator, for it. Perhaps we still wanted to say something to Pastor Oziel and did not have opportunity for it. Or if we have failed Pastor Oziel in our thoughts, words, or deeds, we needn't keep it to ourselves, but we may ask the Lord for his forgiveness. And if it so happened that Pastor Oziel hurt us in any way, let us also forgive him. Before we get to the prayer, I want to invite you for a time of silence and reflection. All of you received a little card when you entered into the church. I ask you to write down a message for Cheryl and the family, or if you want to just share a memory of Pastor Oziel that you will treasure with Cheryl and the family. These we will then scan. Alpha will scan it for us next week, and she will send it to the family that can also read what you have written. So Marilyn will play some music now in the background. Once you've finished writing, I ask that you come to the front. There are two baskets. Just put your little note in there, and then I'll gauge when everybody's finished, and then we'll continue with a time of prayer.
Thank you.
Let us stand. Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you with all that is on our hearts this morning. Lord, we bring before you all these memories, all these treasures that we shared with Pastor Aziel. But we also come before you this morning with the pain of saying farewell to our dear friend, whom we will miss, and the love and the memories that we shared with them. But Lord, as we heard just now, we are not perfect. We do make mistakes. So we also come before you now, and we bring all those things before you that came between us. The things we did or did not do, the words that we spoke or did not speak. And we ask for your forgiveness. And if Pastor Aziel did anything to hurt us, we also want to forgive him. Our Father, we thank you that you sent your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, into this world to walk among us, to show us your love, to tell the great parable about your love, your mercy, which we sometimes fail to understand. We thank you for his death and that he rose again, through his cross declaring your love to be without limit, for his resurrection that death no longer has the last say. Lord, thank you that through his life we may hear the testimony that death no longer has the last say, but you'll never leave us nor forsake us, that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come can separate us from your love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, lift us up when we are down. Strengthen Cheryl and the family in those days when they miss Oziel. Comfort them and let them feel your presence. Above all, Lord, we ask that you watch over us and keep us safe. Be in our going out and in our coming in, now and forever. And we end this prayer with the words that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We await the resurrection of the dead and the new life to come, as our Lord has promised it to us. Go out under the blessing of the Lord. May the Lord be ahead of us to show us the right way. May the Lord be next to us to secure us in his arms, to guard us against the threats from left and right. May the Lord be behind us to shelter us against anxiety and fear. May the Lord be under us to sustain us when we fall. May the Lord be in us to comfort us in our sorrows. May the Lord be above us to bless us. So blesses us the throne God, God our Creator, Jesus Christ our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit our Sanctifier. Amen. I ask that you remain standing for our last hymn that we want to sing. And it's also a hymn that Pastor Aziel loves playing on his guitar, Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace.
mind, based on Psalm 121, beside the quiet waters. Brigitte wrote this hymn, and Pastor Aziel also helped her with it. And thereafter, you are welcome to leave the church building. Marilyn will also still play something for us as we go out. Thank you, Marilyn, for playing the organ again after all of this time. I know it's in Chris's first time back into this church building after the fire. It's lovely to hear the organ.